Welcome back to another episode of Ideas to Human Better. I am Eva Payne, and I am so excited about my guest today, Maren Muter. She is a phenomenal human, and I watched an interview with her. She's right here. You can see her if you're watching this. I saw her on an interview with Regina Meredith, and I'll put the link down below. So if you want to go ahead and check that out, you can. And as you may know, I'm working on this podcast, a series called After Our Last Breath, and where I interview really cool people about what they think happens to us that moment that we die and move on to whatever is next. And Maren, when I was listening to you, I just kept hearing like, you've got to interview her. You've got to interview her. So I love that you said yes. And so thank you so much for being here today.
Yeah. Well, thank you for having me. It's very nice to see you and meet you and to meet all of you.
I love it. Thank you. Thank you. So before we dive in, for the people who do not know you or who are new to you, can you just tell everyone a little bit about you, a little bit about your background, and what might bring you here today, why this is an area where you might have some experience.
Sure. Well, I grew up in the Pacific Northwest in Oregon. And when I was young, I would write letters, poems, predictions, and theories to what I would call the Flower Lady. The Flower Lady is somebody that resides on the other side of the veil. And I would write to her as if I was writing home. So I was here earthbound and it felt more like camp. And I would write these predictions and theories on life and little poems. And I would bury them everywhere I went for about 13 years. It was age four and 17. And about 45 years later, I ended up unearthing those and ended up writing the Book of Buried Letters, which is a compilation of several of these letters and a little bit of the story behind it. I have studied consciousness for about 30 years and really delved into the after-death communication and the continuation of consciousness in the last 10 years. And working with people that have near-death experiences and a lot of people that have had loved ones pass away, whether they were children, parents, spouses, or whomever, and talk about the communication that is coming in from the people that have departed or the spiritual entities that have departed. One thing that I really study is what I call parallel existences or parallel lives, and how that affects what we have as a whole life review once we pass on. And it ends up making a lot of sense and puts a lot of the ideas out there that might seem linear into a more comprehensive look at our lives here and how we are in a constant state or a constant form of personal mediumship between our earthbound self and the other side of the veil where the majority of our consciousness actually resides.
Mm. So in your philosophies or beliefs, is the Eva, that is me here, mm-hmm. I'm just a fraction of this larger consciousness of Eva or of Correct. More than just Eva?
Yeah. So Eva would be more of a teeny tiny piece of a larger consciousness. So it's not necessarily Eva up there, but you're definitely part of whatever is up there. Your consciousness probably doesn't have a name. And it's just basically an energetic being and it's not even a being because there's really no parameters around it, but an energetic consciousness and intellectual consciousness up there that's more observational here, observing how your human vessel called Eva is moving about and handling different situations and going about this life and how you're interacting with the world around you, basically. And your Eva here is actually experiencing and playing out every possible scenario that could ever happen. So let's say that you were driving down the highway and you missed your exit. So you're going to think that you continued down that highway missing your exit, but there is a branch of your existence that actually took the exit And in the end, we get to play out simultaneously the result of every single one of our decisions and choices and events that could have possibly happened in this life.
Do you know what? I thought about that before, where I think, don't think that thought, because it actually creates this thought bubble that actually goes out and is played out in real life. Yeah. So it's interesting that you say that, because I always think like, there's some other version of me that didn't take that path, that there's some other version of me that made that choice instead.
Correct.
So if that is true, then how do I ask this question? Can this version of me here pick any of the paths? Do I have like preference, or does that not really exist because the other version of me thinks it has preference? Does that make sense?
That makes exact sense. So every path or every version that we take believes that you've taken and made the best decision possible for you at that time. So even if it's choosing between vanilla and chocolate ice cream, you think that the chocolate ice cream was the absolute choice, and the part of you that took the vanilla ice cream thinks that that's the possible best choice. So we don't intentionally, because that's not how we're created. Our vessel, our human vessel, is not created to make the worst possible choice. It's created to make the best possible choice. And what the end result of that, I mean, it might not be the best thing with the end result, but at the same time, that's the path that we took. And so, we take ownership of each one of those trajectories that we're on.
I think about that sometimes, like, I don't want to say the word fighting, but am I like in a race with another parallel version of me that is making whatever the quote unquote optimal choice is, because only one version of is going to live that optimal choice. So does that make sense? Like, I wonder, am I choosing the most optimal, or at the end of the day, are they all optimal because it all goes back to one, and I want to, the I, that is the bigger collective of the I, wants to experience each of them. So there is no optimal.
Yeah. It's very important that you experience every single iteration that there is. So because that, as a result, good or bad, creates what is the most in-depth form of compassion that you can ever have. And when I say compassion, it's something much greater than love. And it's something that we actually can't comprehend here on this side, on this earthbound plane, because we don't get to see all of and feel and experience all of the different things that are going on there. So it ends up creating an absolute stunning depth of understanding and a stunning depth of compassion, not only towards ourselves, but to the world around us. And when we die, all of those iterations simultaneously come together and create what is a whole. So when we're thinking linear, we're seeing, okay, maybe we have a version of us that didn't make it, past inception. And then we have a version of us that lived to about 108 years old. We'll just pretend that age there. But in the grand scheme of things, time and space don't work in a linear plane that we get to see right now as we go down each one of these trajectories. They all fizzle out basically at the exact same time. So if you think of like a big boomer firework, and you watch that big boomer firework, and it doesn't matter from the center onto the outside, it all kind of goes away exactly the same time. Mm-hmm. And when we are created at inception, we create what is a zinc explosion. It's literally a firework. So it's a three-dimensional thing. It's been recorded, and it's a zinc explosion. It looks just like a firework. And every single one of those little particles that is coming off of that is a trajectory, is us. And we start playing out every scene. So some of us don't make it past inception. Mm-hmm. Some of us are, the mother had a miscarriage, and some of us have been aborted, and I'm saying us, like a piece of our life. And some of us, don't make it past birth. Some of us make it only a couple days, but we get to experience absolutely everything that could be up. Some of us might, as children had leukemia. Some of us might have been in an incredibly abusive situation. Some of us might have had, our parents, because our parents are playing out every single trajectory too. So mm-hmm. there's so many different versions of this puzzle. Some of us might make choices that actually lead us to become bank robbers, and some of us might have choices that lead us to become, you know, the person that was in the bank being robbed. So we get to experience the yin and yang of life. And then all of that comes together when our firework dissipates. It all comes right back together and we get to experience the whole.
So I have so many questions that are like flooding into my mind at once. It's sure. Like, I just which way do I go? Okay. So how does knowing this shape your everyday life? How does knowing what you know determine the choices that you make today?
That's a very good question. So this is kind of something that I've known at a very young age. I realized that this was going on at a very young age. So, and I would write about this in the letters that I would bury. I think that how it ended up shaping how I am was I actually had to learn to put myself into other people's shoes a little bit more. I mean, we can't really put ourselves into other people's lives, but we can do our best to understand it. And once I learned that other people didn't necessarily see life how I was seeing it at 3 or 4 years old, I started having to pay attention to what linear choices looked like rather than an encompassing choice looks at. So I would see people say, okay, well, this is how it is. And we're going basically from point A to point B, and it's a straight line. And this is what life dealt you, and we're stuck with it. And so seeing life through other people's eyes or seeing life through the linear trajectory was very humbling to me. So it almost gave me the opposite effect that what some people will get when they die and have all of the pieces come together. For me, it was very humbling to see how others look at life in a linear trajectory. Then I started learning, as I started doing more study and more research and more people started coming to me, that people were told that they made spiritual agreements before they came down here to have certain events and certain markers along this linear chain happen. And that is what they decided they were going to come down and do. They made agreements to do these things. And when I heard that, I was shocked, because in my view, and when I see life how I see it, I take things very seriously. When I make a choice, I understand that I'm making two choices. I understand that I'm doing both. And with that comes a great responsibility, because I know that some of the choices I make could end up hurting someone, and some of the choices I make, I could be hurt, or it could just be a nice floaty choice, which would be great. but it comes with a big responsibility. So when I hear people say that we made soul agreements before we came down here to be abused as children, or we made soul agreements to come down here to have horrible things happen because we had a lesson to learn, whoever is teaching that is teaching that from a single point, is teaching that from a single trajectory. When we go up and once we pass, we're in a state of ultimate compassion, like we were talking about soon at the beginning of this interview. And if you're in a state where it is ultimate compassion, if you're in a state where it is love, there is no way that you're going to have somebody or something up there coming to you and saying, you know, you didn't learn this lesson. You didn't learn how to abuse and beat and torture a child. And you need to find somebody that will pair up with you that will allow you to do that. So you go around and you're like, okay, well, you meet somebody and you're like, oh, you know what? I haven't had a chance to kill or hurt or torture a child, would you be willing to do that? And then the child says, oh, or the other entity says, oh yeah, I'll come and I'll let you do that. So baby is born and is put in this horrible situation. And when someone then says, when that person has become an adult and they're suffering and they're trying to figure all of this out, says, well, you know, you chose that. That was part of your decision to come down here. What that does is that puts part of the responsibility of the predator onto the prey and turns that prey into a victim, which is detrimental, because in the grand scheme of things, what a predator is somebody that has a chemical imbalance or wiring that's incorrect in the brain, not the mind, but in the brain. So in this physical body, there's something short-circuiting, basically. And that short circuit, it's like when a dog gets rabies. If we think of Old Yeller was a great dog, but then he got rabies and was in excruciating pain and attacked and lashed out at the world around him. But that wasn't spiritual, that was physical, that was physiological. And most predators come from a physiological state. And it is nowhere in the grand scheme of things or even possible that the victim or the prey that predator was attacking had any responsibility to do that. And so for me, going back to your question, how does my view of an understanding of this parallel existence affect how I go through life here? It really does give me a very humbling experience for myself, due to the responsibility that I know that there are multiple things that are going to play out, and I'm going to be a part of all those. But then it also gives me great humility to understand and to listen to how other people are seeing and viewing life and how that affects their lives personally. And so when I speak to people, I really do take that into consideration, and I have a great understanding and compassion for the person that is sitting in front of me.
I love that. So what do you say to someone who has been through a lot of trauma in their past? Like what is the answer, if there's an answer, or what is the best coping mechanism or tool or something that someone can use to help them find peace with it, move beyond it, so that it doesn't hold them back from expressing their fullness and essence in a beautiful way moving forward?
Yeah. Well, you know, when someone has had trauma, when someone has had things happen in their life that, you know, aren't necessarily great, the first thing is to process it and to understand, you know, to do the best of understanding your feelings. So we kind of work a little bit backwards. I do a lot of listening. So we take it from the outer emotions. And outer emotions mean, when I say that, those are protective emotions. And so that would be anger and hate and these very hard expressions of emotion that are actually created to put a barrier up to prevent further injury. So that's where a lot of those emotions come from. They're put up like a shield, and they are there to prevent further injury onto the body or, you know, your physical being and your soul that is inside this body, because your soul outside the body is fine and healthy and is not in pain. What you're feeling is a very physical earthbound feeling, and what you're experiencing is very earthbound. So we speak about that, and I do a lot of talking. I do a lot of listening, and you do get to do a lot of talking. And if we end up sitting in silence, we do that as well. But it's not a quick fix, because there's a lot of untangling that we will be doing. And then as that happens, and as this untangling happens, and as we start understanding where these outer emotions are coming from, then you get to start experiencing life and allowing that vulnerability to come out and just sometimes just peek outside and say, okay, I'm going to be here for a little bit, and then you can come and tuck back in. But allowing vulnerability so you can start connecting and reconnecting with the world around you, connecting and reconnecting with the people around you, mm-hmm. and creating bonds, whether they're small and, you know, just gentle bonds or, you know, deeper bonds. But until we get back to the source, until we kind of dive into the anger and frustration and hurt, the outer emotions, that's how we make progress, I guess. Mm. I lost my thought there.
No, yeah. No, I'm right there with you. I definitely feel that. I think that trauma can really hold people back sometimes, and we just we sit in it for so long, and we don't believe that we can move past it, or don't even, it's scary. You're so comfortable with it because that's all you've known. And so you don't even believe that life can be experienced in a different way. And so having someone like you there to coach and help people through that, I think that's really beautiful and very important work. So thank you for that. Okay. So my next question, going back to this idea that the little piece of me is going back to this bigger piece of me. Mm-hmm. Beyond that layer, okay, and I'm kind of jumping to something bigger, but beyond that layer, do those bigger pieces of us all come back together again? Like, so your bigger version and my mm-hmm. bigger version, do we connect somewhere down the road?
Yeah.
All right, tell me a little bit about that.
So we have an ultimate consciousness. So we have an overarching consciousness that resides on the other side of the veil. And I think it's important to understand where this veil is coming from and how the veil is being created. The veil is actually nothing out here around you. The veil is actually created in your mind, between your mind and your brain. So as we're developing, our brain is basically a receiver. And its job is to demodulate information, so to decode information coming in. So our whole body is kind of a receiver, so we can feel energy, different wavelengths and stuff all over our body. And we get different messages coming in. And it's our brain's job to take the information, the external stimulus and the internal stimulus, and turn it into something recognizable and something that makes sense. So as we're developing and our brain is developing, what's happening is in utero, we have basically a free flow of information. We are fully connected to the other side of the veil because our brain is not fully developed yet. And as the brain starts developing, it's kind of acting like a radio. So it's tuning into different frequencies that are important and relevant to our life here, important and relevant to our survival here. And as it's doing that, it's finding information that we can use immediately. And then as we learn that information, we recognize and we comprehend the information that's coming in, the frequencies open up just a little bit more and a little bit more. So it's kind of like if we think of a faucet and the faucet's completely off when we are born, basically. I mean, there's a little bit opening, but as we develop and as we learn our environment and communication styles and stuff with others, the faucet turns on a little bit more, it turns on a little bit more, it turns on a little bit more. And then sometimes we want it a little bit hotter and we want it a little bit colder. And so it's always, our brain is always tuning into different frequencies. If we didn't do that, if our brain didn't create this filter system, then what it would be like is, imagine being in your car and you turn the radio on and every single radio station on the face of the planet, like every radio station on the face of the planet is coming out at one time. And then it's your job listening to all of this to try to figure out the directions to the grocery store. Well, that would be nearly impossible and you would short circuit. So that's what your brain is doing. Your brain's job is to create the veil. Your brain's job is to create this barrier between you and the internal realms, because it's so much information out there that has nothing to do with this life here. So that's really the brain's job. And how can we see that this brain is working this way? Well, we look at savantism, or people that have access to information, more information than they should, information that, you know, doesn't correlate with our development. So we look at kids that have amazing artistic abilities, and we look at children that have amazing mathematical abilities or scientific abilities or writing or all of these different things. And what's happening is when our brain developed at that time, for some reason, one of these frequencies stayed a little bit open. Now, on the whole, when we have people that have savantism, we'll just use mathematics, and let's say that they understood calculus at five. There's going to be a point, not all the time, sometimes it just keeps going and they learn a lot more than calculus, or they know a lot more than calculus and nobody ever catches up. But we look at, you know, during the evolution of the average life, many times there's people that can catch up to that level of savantism. So they have learned their lessons, they've learned 1 + 1 = 2, and then once they understood that and comprehended that, the faucet opened just a little bit more, or the radio tuned in a little bit more, and now we learned that 1 - 1 = 0, 1 × 1 = 1, 1 / 1 = 1. So all the way up to calculus, and then all of a sudden now we start getting peer-to-peer and age-appropriate understanding. Sometimes the people that have savantism, the frequency is open a lot more and they can see a lot more and understand a lot more, just because that frequency for some reason didn't close off to have the gradual means of understanding through them.
So do you think that if, like, let's say that individual that has that gift in a certain area, if they nurture that gift, would someone who just put in the work ever really catch up? Like, if they're both running the race.
Absolutely. They could.
Yeah.
They could end up catching up. So, because there's only a certain amount of that information that is actually going to be relevant to life here. And so it could be that maybe they start, the person that has the savantism, maybe the filter starts closing in a little bit. And that does happen, just because it needs to hone in on some of these things, because they have to be able to communicate in some way, shape, or form here on Earth. And we see the struggle with communication. We see the struggle with interacting with, peer-to-peer and, just interactions. And it looks a little bit different. We might not understand it. There's two things. One can catch up and one might just not keep going. Then they could keep nurturing it. They could keep delving in and going farther and farther and farther. But they're also, by doing that, they aren't getting the whole picture, because as they do that, they're negating the development of other frequencies coming in. So they might not understand, more English or language skills and things like that. There's always a balance.
I love that. Okay. So here's my other question for you is, can we meet the other versions of us? Like, if I go into some deep meditation and I'm like, all right, I want to see the Eva that never started the nonprofit at 21. I'm sure she is out there wondering the same thing, because if we're all alike. So have you ever met, or would you even want to? I mean, I just think it'd be interesting. Yeah. But like, connect with another parallel version of you and see that life, or but while still in this life, instead of having to die to meet that person.
Exactly. Well, number one, yes. When you die, you get to see it all. But sometimes we do get snippets of what's going on in the other experience, the other life experience. Sometimes we can get feelings of what's going on in the other life experience, and it usually resonates. Sometimes we get that deja vu moment where maybe the other experience had already gone through this place, or maybe we're leading the way, and for some reason those two paths ended up crossing, and then we get kind of that deja vu feeling. Mm-hmm. When we look at how and where these other trajectories of ourselves reside, it's obviously not on this exact same universal plane. And if we look at what science is studying in regards to dark matter, dark energy, and then just matter, even up in space. We see that dark matter, it is kind of helping hold some of these nebula in our universe together, which would normally be expanding out and things like that. So if you were to actually be able to see this dark matter, it would look like webbing. It would look like an intricate webbing, moving and connecting everything into place. So we have also I'm trying to explain it easily here. So if we look at quantum theoretics and we see or we hear and read about quantum entanglement and quantum superposition, where we can have particles that are still interacting with each other. And at the same time, when we look at quantum theoretics, one particle can be in multiple places simultaneously at the exact same time. So we don't necessarily get to say, yes, I want to go see what happened on this trajectory, or I wonder what happened. But we are intimately connected because we are the exact same particle playing out different viewpoints of this life experience. And it's at maybe small, different universal planes that could be, feels like exactly where we are now. But that's where dark matter and dark energy come into play, because it actually enables this multiple experience to happen. That's what's actually enabling it. But you might be able to get visual snippets. You might be able to get visual or physiological feelings, emotions, and stuff like that, because you still are connected to all of that.
It's so interesting. As you were, right before you said deja vu, I wrote down deja vu. That makes perfect sense. There have been moments in my life where the deja vu was so strong that I could see the next 20 seconds. I mean, I not maybe beyond that, but I knew exactly this person's going to walk in. This person's going to say that. It was like everything perfectly lined up. And it was so weird. I'm sitting here like, oh my gosh, this is happening. This is happening. And then the second I like really started seeing it come together was when it would dissipate. Like once the more awareness I put on it, like this is happening. Oh my goodness. then it was like back out into like, it left me. So it's fascinating. Okay. So my next question, synchronicity, tell me what that is to you. What are synchronicities?
Okay, give me an example. Synchronicity is a huge word for me. And so
a synchronicity would be like Carl Jung describes it as a meaningful connection between two different points. So it's me talking to my sister and saying, oh my gosh, I have this idea, blah, blah, blah. You should do this. And she goes, funny, you should say that. The lady down the street was just talking to me about that. Mm-hmm. And then tomorrow she watches something and it's that exact message coming in again. Yeah. So it's these to someone else, it may mean nothing, but it's just when everything sort of aligns and you're on a path and things just start happening, like you getting your house or the things that you just think, what the heck? So all these meaningful things that seem to tie into meaning, purpose,
type of thing. Okay. So we'll go from that synchronicity.
Okay.
Those synchronicities happen when we are paying attention to a certain thing. So if I was to say, okay, today I want everybody to just think about an orange car, and every time, just see how many orange cars show up. And so some people call this, manifesting destiny, which, is a whole other subject. But I've seeded an idea, and you might have been seeded this idea previously and it might not have stuck. So when you call your sister and you're like, okay, you should have this or do this. And then the neighbor said that, she's like, oh my gosh, it might have been even a month or two or a year before the original idea was seeded. Maybe she saw something and it didn't quite register earthbound consciousness or forward consciousness, but it was kind of sitting in the back of our brain. And then you say something, and then all of a sudden, it's like me saying, okay, I just want you to think about an orange car and just see what happens. Well, your brain is automatically going to now seek out the orange cars. So it's not that there's more orange cars, it's just that now your brain is paying attention and picking up on that. And that's kind of how synchronicity works. So you've been seated with an idea, someone else says it, and then all of a sudden it's, you're starting to pick it out. You're starting to listen. You're starting to kind of tune into that, saying, okay, there's something going on here, and maybe I should start listening to it because I'm starting to see more orange cars. And then maybe you'll end up going to buy an orange car. Who knows?
but that's actually drives an orange car.
Yeah, that's kind of how synchronicity works. It's kind of like you're, you know, really, really wanting a piece of cake, and you're telling you're even denying yourself that I'm not going to do it. And then within a month, there's going to be a piece of cake there, and you're like, all right, I'll have the cake. but there's nothing in this life that isn't for without reason. So even if it's so minute, there is a reason, a rhyme and reason that something happens. And again, it's not always good and it's not always bad. But there is a reason that you're crossing paths with someone. There's a reason you've passed by a certain tree. There's a reason that, you know, you woke up with a huge crease on your face because you were sleeping like that. I mean, there's always a reason for everything that is happening.
All right. So what is the purpose of life? Do we have individual purposes? Is there some greater purpose? What is the purpose of even being here and going through all of this for each of us?
Well, the purpose here in this life, because we are playing out the whole, so we're going to negate the single strand of life, which takes off. It takes off karma. It takes off a lot of these other things that we have been taught over the years, and it creates this whole experience. So when we look at this whole experience, and we look and understand what this incredible depth of compassion is, the experience here on the earthbound plane is more for observation. And it's not necessarily our human vessel observation, but it's for consciousness observation. So when we are part of our main eternal overarching consciousness, we have this globe, this earth down here, and it's connected to absolutely everything. So we really can't isolate that. But we get to say, okay, well, what if we take these two human vessels and we bring them together? And I know this is sounding like a science experiment, but it's so much, there's so much more depth and there's so much more love and compassion and understanding that goes behind this. But simply put, our overarching consciousness is saying, okay, what if we put these two human vessels together? And we combine them. And out of that combination, we get this, another human vessel. And how is that human vessel then going to proceed and handle different stimulations? So in this environment, they're born in this environment, how are they going to proceed and go about that? How are they going to handle interaction? What happens if, you know, we put in this experience, how is that going to branch off and stuff like that? So it's more observational. Just as we are observing this planets, and just as we are observing, you know, whatever's happening on the Petri dish, we're observational creatures. Through observation, it allows us on the earthbound stage to step back and learn to respond rather than react. React is a very physical, physiological expression of what's going on here. But when we step back and when we get the chance to observe, we get the chance to look at the picture as a whole, go through, and then all of a sudden we're able to respond to situations, which actually ends up making them much better, no matter how horrible they are, because we allow ourselves a deeper understanding of what's going on. And that's part of this incredible compassion that is coming through. So if we look around and we look at nature and we look at life around us, it truly is observational. And someone asked me one time, you know, what are the most intelligent creatures on the planet? And I would say the trees, or if you look at a whale. And it's because we think of meditation or something like that, but think of the things that are the most observational beings on the earth and how absolutely stunning and beautiful they are. Mm-hmm. And that's, and we can be stunning and beautiful when we step back and we learn to respond rather than react.
So do my choices ultimately matter? If there's another version of me who's making optimal choices.
Your choices ultimately matter. So every choice you make matters. And because even though you're going to be making both choices, so even though you really think that this is the best choice that you can make and you're making both of them, the reason why it matters is because then you take ownership of that trajectory. And by going down that trajectory of this hole, then you are able to then experience and understand and learn exactly what the results of that choice were. And that contributes to the whole. So
every choice. I love that. So I thought about this every once in a while.
But you shouldn't, you shouldn't stress over every choice. Like, don't make yourself sick over every choice, because it's going to work out exactly how it's supposed to work out. Good, bad, or ugly, it's there. But take ownership of the choice you make. That's the important part. Taking ownership and saying, yes, I made this decision.
Mm-hmm. Right. This version of me, this path of me. Right. I love that. I've thought about this, the book, The Hunger Games, or the movie, The Hunger Games, and how there's this sort of outside world that gives you things like, what are you going to do with that? And what about that? And you know what? Let's drop this in. So there's been times where I'm like, hello out there, if you're listening, I could use a little guidance right now.
Yeah.
I'm listening. So do you think there is some outside source that is impacting or guiding, or is it really just an observer and it's all on you and whatever happens is just the collective of the individuals / everything around us, nature, making its own choices?
Yeah. So when you're saying hello out there, please listen to me. I need you're actually talking to yourself. You're actually using a form of personal mediumship, and you're actually talking to your consciousness, your overall consciousness. And yes, your overall consciousness is going to say, okay, well, let's see about that. Especially if you're having a really hard time making a choice, especially when you're agonizing over it and you're like, oh my gosh, this is going to kill me. And your consciousness says, okay, well, here you go. Try this, you know? And so there's constantly little things going on, because they are observing and they are taking this human vessel and saying, okay, well, what happens if? What happens? How are you going to react and respond to this? You know, what is going to be the result of that? So sometimes, yes, you're playing games with yourself. But, you know, your overall consciousness is doing that. But it's not being cruel to you. It's really not. It's just saying, here, try this.
I love that. Okay. So here's the big question.
Okay.
I'm at whatever point I'm at, whatever brings it on. But I have taken my last breath on this plane in this existence.
Okay.
What am I going to experience next?
Okay. So this is where we get to put the whole story together. Mm-hmm. And we're just going to talk about the exact next. When we were created, when the sperm hit the egg, we created a firework, a bright explosion of light. When we are removed from this human vessel, so we have to remember that this human vessel has a lot of energy in it. We are an electromagnetic organism. And when we finish, it kind of sparks. So we enter another light. So some people say it's an ethereal white light. Some people say it's an ethereal darkness, but it is an ethereal light. And the reason why we can't really put our finger on it to figure out what color it is because it's ethereal. It's nothing that we on this earthbound side can describe. So that's why when people have near-death experiences and they come back, sometimes they literally say, I can't describe it, because they can't describe it. But when we leave this body, we create a little bit of a removal. So it's like when you lift, well, now I'm going to age myself, but you lift your bed sheets and it creates a spark because you don't have fabric softener in there. But it's the same thing where when our spirit, our little teeny tiny man, it's just the smallest speck of spirit inside the body. When that leaves, it creates the spark. Inside that spark is the end of your firework. So now we've had this big boomer 4th of July firework. We're expanding out and we have all the little cracklies at the end. And then all of a sudden it just kind of goes, and then it's done. Well, during that, when it's done, that's when all of these pieces come together. So remember, no matter how long or short, it does dissipate simultaneously. And all of these pieces come together, and it's an instantaneous understanding, an instantaneous recognition, an instantaneous moment of humility adds to this incredible compassion that then rejoins and comes back up into the overarching consciousness, which is full of all of these different experiences, the different life experiences, whether they were earthbound experiences or experiences, you know, in a completely different multidimensional plane somewhere else. So that's literally what's happened. When you die, you're not going through every single event. You're not, I mean, you are, but it's so quick and it creates this hole, but you're not sitting up there being tortured. And if for some reason something happened to you, you're not being punished. So let's say someone did something and there's some, you know, beliefs out there that they are in limbo or they are stuck or they are in timeout or, you know, they have to process their life here and they're stuck. We're instantly part of our overarching consciousness. There's nothing stuck, nothing there, because it's literally the separation from returning the earthbound vessel to the earth, where all the nutrients and minerals and particles and molecules return to the earthbound stage and feed other forms of life. And our spiritual or our consciousness returns back to the other side of what was formerly the veil.
So I thought about this a lot. I think about this light or this thing people say, like, I see this light and I went into it. Or can you choose not to go? Can you just sit there and like go, I see you. I don't, how do you know to trust it? How do you know? Like, I mean, cause I've heard, you know, I investigate this. I listen to a lot of people talk about what happens to us. And there are people who are like, it's going to zap your memory. It's going to suck you in and spit you back out. And you're just going to keep having this life over and over in different forms. And so it's not good. And so that makes me go like, oh man, is it really? Like, so can I just pause for a second and like wait around and sort of be like, let's just have a discussion there. Light, energy, consciousness, whatever you are.
Yeah.
So you don't feel like tricked into going, you know, I don't know. I guess I question that instead of just believing it's whole and beautiful because that's what it feels like. I mean, if I were to develop a divisiveness on the other side, that's how I would trick people in. I'd be like, oh, it's going to feel like love. It's going to feel like wholeness.
Yeah.
And then it's going to suck you in and zap you and spit you back out onto earth again.
Yeah.
So how do you know that's not true? I guess is my question.
Yeah. So sometimes we look at things as a cycle. And right now, that belief system that you're talking about, again, is linear, because right now we're looking at a line going in a circle, and where we're going through our life phase, and then we're dying, and then we go up here again, and we have no more memory, and then all of a sudden we're being sucked back in, and we didn't learn our lessons, or we have karma, or, you know, we're being punished, and we have to come back, and we're coming back in again, and it just kind of keeps going in this circle. So it's very two-dimensional in that regards. When we listen to people that have near-death experiences that say, oh, I went to the other side of the veil and I saw amazing, great things. And then someone said, oh, well, you have a choice. You can stay or you can go. Well, again, that's part of this whole. You're going to do both. You're going to die and you're also going to come back into this exact life. So we're talking about a near-death experience here. Mm-hmm. Because that's going to be part of the experience, not only for you to have your end life end there, but then you also get to play out what happens if you hadn't died. And the people that are left behind here get to experience what it was like to have you die at that particular point, or to have you come back, and then how does that affect their life at that time? So again, we get, when we have a choice, anytime that there is a choice, you're going to play out both of those roles. When we go to the other side of the veil, again, is not necessarily streets lined in gold and buildings and things like that, because that's all material here. Mm-hmm. The other thing is when people come back to talk about what was on the other side of the veil, we have to look at our brain again, because our brain literally has to translate whatever information that they had and you experienced up there and bring it back down. So sometimes you hear people that have a near-death experience that literally describe hell. And the reason why it looks like hell is because your brain isn't comprehending what it saw. And maybe it had been told to you earlier in your life that if you see these things, if you experience that, that is wrong. And it is not good, and because, you know, they are trying to portray another thing. And so your brain starts saying, oh, I saw this, and that is going to equal bad because that's what I was told. And then all of a sudden, now you're in the fiery depths of hell, and that's what your brain created. It's kind of like when you have a computer, and I think Google did an experiment years ago, I know they did, on having the computer generate the world's best art. And so they let the computer learn, look, and search on what makes good art. And then the computer generated a picture. And when that picture came out, it was like literal hell. So you had like dog heads growing off of grass leaves. And you had people with, you know, chicken wings coming. I mean, it looked horrible. But that's what the computer understood to be good art. So it put all of the elements of good art together and created a nightmare. And that's what your brain will do. And so it has to translate information from the other side of the veil into something that we understand, into something that we can communicate here. So when we hear about this cycle of life and that you're dying and then all of a sudden you have to come back because of karma and all of this stuff, when we have these near-death experiences and we're bringing in them back, we bring them back not only in a linear state, but we bring them back in a translated state from our brain. And so sometimes that's why the stories can look different, because they are very individual to our experience here. So you're not going to get stuck, and you're not going to be forced back in to redo this life because you didn't do something. So you can not worry about that.
Do you believe in reincarnation? Is there some sort of reincarnation of our essence, our spirit, a piece of us that decides to come live some life again? Or is it one and done?
Yes, but not necessarily as reincarnation. Again, when we look at it through an observational plane and we look at it as our overarching consciousness, wanting to see what happens if we put two entities together, and let's say, what happens if we do this combination in Africa and now we're in a totally different area, and how is that going to affect that? So it's more of, you know, allowing ourselves to observe, our consciousness to observe, and in the end it creates a whole. So there's nothing incomplete, and so there's not necessarily this rejuvenation of the exact same experience. Mm-hmm. Now, sometimes people have memories of other life experiences, which we call past life experiences. But that's not because it was an incomplete life. That's not because they needed to do something. It's just because for some reason, especially when they're children, we see this mostly in children, those frequencies, just like savantism, stayed open. And so we just have different access to different points. And now why do we remember certain events? It's exactly like this life here. We don't remember every single event, even if we're looking on our one trajectory. You don't remember every single event, but you remember milestones of what happened. And that's, so you might pick out milestones, but there's no unfinished business. But sometimes we, because we are connected, because these experiences are part of the whole, we still have access to them.
I love that. I had a friend who explained it as, if you're one drop of water, you go back to the pool or the sea, and then another drop gets taken out, but it's never the exact same drop because now it's mixed back with the whole. My twins, when they were maybe like 5 years old, they were sitting at the table and the one looked at the other and said, do you remember when we were old men and had beards? And we're just sitting there like, what? So do you think that we, if there is some sort of version of that collectiveness, that consciousness coming back to just have a different experience, whatever the reason might be, that you're connected to other people. So like my twins, for example, they've that consciousness that is them existed some other time in some other place and they chose or were just given this opportunity to be in this life again together? Do we travel these lives with some of the same people?
Yes and no. So if we look at how we are connected to Earth itself, so let's just only focus on Earth right now because it's much bigger. We are literally part of the Earth. Our body was grown of the Earth. And so we can't make or destroy any matter here. Okay. Mm-hmm. So we have the same amount, which means that it's constantly being recycled. And then we have what's called particular memory. So particles always have memory. Water has memory. And we are made of all of these different memories. So this body is connected to the whole. And we see this if we just look at, And I know I say this often in this story, just the connection itself. So again, if we observe our connection, what we breathe in is what the tree breathed out. And what the tree breathes in is what we breathed out. And so there's intimate connection to the earth around us. And so when we have memories sometimes of different lives, sometimes people have memories of being an aquatic creature. Sometimes that's just particular memory. Sometimes that doesn't even mean that it was a life experience that we had. And sometimes it does mean that it's a life experience that we had, but we're all in this together. And that is a cliche that everybody, you know, we hear that over and over and over again. But my version of we are all in this together is because we are all made of the exact same material. Our material has connection billions of years old. And so we might meet someone that has a very close connection to us, and we might meet someone that we have very repelling energy with. And that could be due to particular memory. So it could be repelling energy between a former fire molecule and a former water molecule, and they don't really want to touch. So we don't know, you know, exactly where some of these memories are coming from, but there is connection. So if your twins remember being together, it could be particular memory or it could be spiritual memory. And it just depends on, you know, this, when you go into conversation with them, you'll be able to figure out what it was. But that doesn't mean that they are going to be together forever all the time.
Right.
Because we're just disconnected.
That makes perfect sense. Yeah. And I don't know that the other one was like, yeah, I remember. I think it was just the one saying it. Saying it. I just thought that was weird for five-year-olds to be saying that. I have thought about that everything, well, I guess besides like comets or something, but pretty much everything that's on this earth has always been on this earth. Like you said, it's all recycled. It's the water that we drink is the same water in some form that was here when the dinosaurs were here, or ancient Egypt, or whatever. And water in itself is fascinating to me, how it just, it's so alive and all.
It is.
Anyhow,
you said something really interesting. You said, aside from comets, but I was just looking earthbound, but the earth is part of what? The earth is part of the universe, which is part of that. So all of this material, so you literally have star, you are literally made of stardust. So you have particles that are billions of light years away inside your body right now. So you literally are connected to the whole. You're beautiful. That's absolutely.
So amazing. That's so amazing. Okay. Random question as we wrap up. So do you believe in other intelligent life, like not Homo sapiens sapiens that exist today on our interacting or not, but like, when, how does that, if you do, how does that tie in to the bigger picture, and why don't we all know about it more openly?
Because we're human.
Tell me more.
Our consciousness and our understanding of life really is determined on our physical vessel, on our earthbound vessel. And we are created to understand life through the human being. So there, everything has consciousness, and it just expresses it differently. And because it expresses it differently, we think, okay, well, maybe it's not as intelligent as us. And why isn't it as intelligent as us? Because, you know, humans are able to do mathematics, and humans are able to do art, and humans are able to do this. Mm-hmm. But that is through human eyes. That is through human understanding. But everything has consciousness. And the more we start diving into this, and the more we start seeing this, we start seeing, hey, there's communication with trees. A tree knows its own young and will actually send water, minerals, whatever it needs to its young to help that young survive. And it knows, I mean, if there's a whole bunch of saplings, it knows which one it is. But we as humans don't necessarily see the understanding and consciousness through the other beings out there, because we don't necessarily understand it. And we think there are so many out there that are absolutely rudimentary. But those creatures or those entities, and I'm just talking earthbound here because I do believe that there's grand consciousness, obviously, all over the place. But here, and on the earthbound stage, we just look at it through human eyes. And so in that sense, that's where humans are kind of ignorant in a way. And I'm saying that nicely, because we really think that we are superior because of what we have built, created, and done. But if we also look at it and just look at what happened during the lockdown, all of these great things that we built, all of the streets and the houses and all this stuff, nature started overtaking. So we started seeing the animals come out and play, and we started seeing whales in the water because shipping had been slowed down. Mm-hmm. And we start seeing animal behavior turn different. And they started, you know, taking over the things that we started, you know, we had done to push the natural world out, to segregate ourselves. Mm-hmm. And in that alone shows, just that little example shows, that there's far more intelligence than we understand and realize out there, and that we are only looking at life through human eyes. So yes, I do think that there's more consciousness. Mm,
I love that. Do you think it's possible for us to overcome war and all this terrible stuff that happens in the world? Or do you think that is just part of the human condition and we just try to live with it as best as we can? Or can we evolve beyond it? I keep waiting for us to evolve beyond it. Like, at what point are people going to be like, yeah, we don't want to do war anymore?
Yeah.
Like, what is that possible?
Yes, it is possible. And it might not look exactly how you want it to look. And so I know that we're running out of time, so I'm going to do this really quickly. Yeah. We battle absolutely everything. So we battle illness and we battle infertility. So we want life to continue on for as long as humanly possible, but literally our vessel is made to decompose. Our vessel is made to cease. We don't want it to continue on. That's why we're organic and that's why we're made of the earth. So when we have two things happening, so we're extending life and we're procreating life through like in vitro fertilizations and stuff like that. And I'm not saying it's wrong because I know how important it is to have a baby and hold them in your arms if you want that. But there has to be something that's going to balance us out and to create a balance. So unfortunately, if we are scientifically extending our lives and doing all of these things, then nature is going to find ways for us to, it's like deer season. People go hunting for deer because they think that they're, you know, we don't want deer to overrun. And so you can shoot so many deer a year. And it's the same thing. Nature is just saying, okay, well, it's human season. And, you know, war is horrid. War, it just wreaks havoc on everyone's lives. I know this intimately. And I didn't fight, but I've had very dear loved ones go through the whole range of whether they were mortally wounded all the way to taking their lives as a result of things like this. And it's part of the human condition, like you said. Ultimately, when civilization gets to some sort of equilibrium, then the need for war will start ceasing and it will have more peaceful times. But until then, until we get to this equilibrium, this is a very natural part of human existence. It has been since the dawn of time, and it will continue to be until we hit a certain equilibrium and understanding. And that is going to be as we start stepping back and understanding that life is about more observation than it is about reaction. War comes from reaction. War is a knee-jerk reaction. And we have spent most of our lives going through it as a knee-jerk reaction. But as we started this interview out, and we start talking about the whole, we start talking about that, yes, we are playing everything out, and we are actually observing. Once we are learning to do that, to react versus respond, when we start more and more start understanding that, then all of a sudden we start having a calmer, peaceful life existence and more harmonious with the natural elements in the world around us.
Beautiful. Maren Muter, thank you so much for being with us today and for sharing all of this wisdom. You are very smart. and you speak from such a loving, kind, whole place, and it's beautiful. I really appreciate this work that you're doing and your willingness to be so open and to be on podcasts like this and like Regina's and all the work that you're doing. So thank you so much for helping us to understand and at least offer up a different perspective, a different filter that we can look at life through. So thank you. I really appreciate it. How can people find you or connect with you if they want to work with you or just learn more about you?
Sure. Well, my website is just marinmuter.com. And you can reach me there. There's contact links there. And then also marinmuter@gmail.com works. And it's very easy.
I love it. Thank you so, so much. I really, really appreciate it. I'm going to end the broadcast and then just say bye to you outside of it. But thank you. Is there any final thoughts that you have for anyone? Anything I didn't ask you, anything you want to leave the audience with before I hit end?
Well, first of all, it was very nice to be here. It was very nice meeting all of your viewers. And the one thing that I like to tell people is you are enough, just as you are. You really are enough. And I think you're beautiful. That's it.
Thank you so much.
All right. Bye-bye.